So you and I spent a lot of time together in Abilene, Texas, the site of Stargate, which, if people here aren't familiar, is OpenAI's big data center with SoftBank and Oracle and Crusoe. You're the developer. So I just wanted to start there. If you haven't seen the premiere episode of The Circuit, we go to Abilene and you can see lots of beautiful shots of data centers rising from the red dirt. But I just wanted to start there and talk about, even in the last 2 months, the progress since then, because you're moving very quickly.
Yeah, no, it's great to see you again, Emily. Even, you know, you look great without a hard hat on, too. Yeah, so, you know, things have been moving very, very quickly in Abilene. You know, at this point, I think I was, like, looking at the, just, like, the number of hours that have been worked. I think it's, we're roughly working 200,000 hours per week, 200,000 man hours per week.
5,000 people there
it's,
now?
It's going to get to 5,000, okay. But today's, like, around 3,500. Total in aggregate in the last year, we've worked about 3 million man hours. So it's, like, a ton of work and, you know, hard work, labor, and efforts gone into sort of making this a possibility. But, you know, the first two buildings, which, you know, we announced last summer, you know, are approaching full completion. And the following six are kind of being stood up as we speak. So a lot of the area that, you know, we went through that, you know, they were doing a lot of the earthwork. There are now steel structures there. Building three kind of has the wall panels on it. We're continuing to move very, very quickly.
So this is not only like maybe the biggest data center ever, but the fastest built data center ever? I mean, you guys started last summer.
Yep.
And when's it going to be powering our ChatGPT?
Yeah, so our, I don't know the exact statistics. Yeah. I mean, people have told me it's the largest data center financing ever. Mm-hmm. We announced a $15 billion facility between Blue Owl as our project capital partner and J.P. Morgan as the credit on the deal. As far as speed goes, that's something that, you know, Crusoe's very focused on. How do we actually accelerate AI innovation by bringing the infrastructure needed to power it to market very, very quickly? So sort of the numbers that I was told was the fastest 100 megawatt mm-hmm. or greater data center had ever been built was roughly 2 years. The first two buildings, which are each 100 megawatts, is roughly 300 days. And then the next six are a little over 200 days. So I think it's about 215 days per building. So all to say, things are moving quickly.
So President Trump announced this the day after the inauguration with Sam, with Masayoshi's son, with Larry Ellison. You didn't necessarily know it was coming. So take me back to that day when Abilene was uttered by Donald Trump.
Definitely like caught us by surprise. But you know, we were sort of happy to, you know, be affiliated with the project. I was actually at a dinner with a bunch of folks in Switzerland, and I sort of had my phone off, and I came out of the dinner, and I had like 15 missed calls and like 25 text messages from all these people saying, "Hey, is this your project? Like, you know, what's going on here? Like, you know, I just watched this announcement in the White House about this thing called Stargate." And I was like, "Wow, I don't even know what's going on." So it was an interesting moment that really catapulted the project into the limelight. But you know, we've been just thrilled to be a part of it, and you know, excited to build this very, very quickly.
So in the episode, we also interview Sam Altman, we interview Masa. You're kind of our tour guide. How did you and Crusoe end up in the middle of this massive deal?
Yeah, I think, you know, I started Crusoe about 7 years ago, and our goal with the business was really taking this energy-first approach to high-performance computing. And, you know, I'd been an AI researcher, mostly focused on quant finance for about a decade before that. I came to appreciate just how much energy a lot of these larger deep learning models used when you sort of were training them at scale. And so, our philosophy was always kind of taking this energy first approach. And, you know, as ChatGPT took off and as the demand for AI infrastructure really, you know, went parabolic, people were very, very capacity constrained. There wasn't enough energy in markets like Northern Virginia. Crusoe was well positioned for this. And in that we had sort of lined up a lot of large quantums of interesting power sources in non-traditional data center markets, like Abilene, Texas. And our goal was really, you know, how do we, instead of trying to build the next data center in Northern Virginia, how do we actually find power so that we can build really big facilities in markets like Abilene? And you know, Abilene is very unique in the sense that there's a ton of wind that's been built there on the back of production tax credits, and wind developers were incentivized by to come there, and so they were sort of getting paid to produce clean power. And one of the big problems is actually they don't have enough demand or transmission to get that power out of that market. And so, you know, it was sort of a perfect fit for a large AI data center. And, you know, we sort of, you know, were well positioned to capitalize on this. And we had some interesting conversations with some of the partners, and everybody sort of locked arms and we said, let's go build the world's biggest AI data center.
Let's talk about how tightly the arms are locked, because, you know, we did talk to a lot of people in Abilene. Residents were mixed. I mean, some people don't really know for sure what it is. They just know this big data center is being built. We talked to a lot of city officials who agreed to give up a lot of tax revenue in order for this data center to be built there. However, nothing would be there otherwise. And so in their view, it's still bringing in millions of dollars that they wouldn't have. I got some calls after the piece aired from folks who are really worried about the power and water demands that this will put on the area. You know, going back to the Texas power crisis in 2021, where like hundreds of people died during blackouts. If the power goes out in Texas, what happens? Does Stargate and ChatGPT stay on, and do the residents lose their power?
Let's see here. So I, where to start? The first thing I'll say is that, you know, from a tax revenue standpoint, you know, the city of Abilene has been a great partner to us, and Taylor County has been a great partner to us as well. And you know, as this facility gets built, we're going to make up about a third of the overall tax budget. So we are a very large contributor to the tax revenue in the city, and about 25% of tax revenue in the county. So we are, I think we're the largest single tax contributor to you know, the local economy. So from that perspective, you know, I feel like we're definitely contributing quite a bit, but, you know, very meaningfully in terms of you know, the overall tax revenue picture. You know, from the power and water perspective, you know, I think we talked about it quite a bit when we were on site. You know, I'll start with the water. On the water side, you know, we actually purposely designed it as a closed loop architecture in the data center, so that we, you know, and the difference between a closed loop and an open loop system is an open loop water cooled system is where you have cold water feeding in, and then you're sort of, you know, creating hot water through the cooling process, and then you're just basically disposing of that hot water.
Right.
When you have a closed loop system, it actually goes through these chillers that basically takes the hot exhaust water and then cools it back down and then recirculates it through the system. Mm-hmm. So while each building requires 1 million gallons of water, you only have to fill it one time, and then it's sort
only
of
one time, because people are like, that's total BS. There's no way.
Yeah, I don't know what to tell them, but
all right.
That's just how it works. You know, there's like probably moments of topping it off a little bit, but this is like every few years. It's not like it's a very, you know, incremental amount. Now on the power side, you know, we've gone through all of the appropriate processes to basically get, you know, the ERCOT approved power load. All of the load studies have been done across the grid to basically ensure that this load is approved and, you know, is not going to disrupt the grid in any sort of, you know, meaningful way. And then we've also invested in backup generation on site. So we've invested in gas generation as a backup resource, which is much cleaner than diesel. We've invested in all of the, you know, most aggressive mechanisms to eliminate pollutants. We've added something called SCRs to our gas turbines. It stands for selective catalytic reducers that basically eliminate almost all of the NOx and the carbon monoxide, the two biggest contributors to smog, so that when we do have to run on the gas turbines, it really mitigates a lot of the local air quality issues that may be associated with you know, that fossil-based generation.
Now, I want to talk, you know, a little more broadly about, you just raised money, you've got a big cloud business, there's, you know, CoreWeave, which recently went public, which is not totally apples to apples, but, you know, you definitely do overlap. You know, can you talk about sort of the bigger picture for Crusoe amidst this data center boom that is not just happening in the U.S., AI data center boom, but around the world?
Sure. You know, Crusoe's an American business, first and foremost, but we do have a global footprint. You know, we've taken a very vertically integrated approach to artificial intelligence, recognizing that, you know, everything has really had to be reinvented, from, you know, the way you source power, to the way you design the data center, to the way you build and operate and manage these clusters with, you know, both physical infrastructure as well as high-performance software. So from that standpoint, we've sort of taken a full-stack approach. You know, certainly there are elements of where CoreWeave is definitely a peer to Crusoe, and I think we've been, you know, sort of rooting on their stock prices. You know, it serves as a great comp to us, and really proves out the success of the business model. You know, I think our biggest footprint is in America, but we, again, taking that energy first approach, we've made massive investments in Iceland, where you have, again, abundant, low cost, clean geothermal and hydropower to power these large clusters of GPUs. That we serve customers both in the US as well as in Europe.
I do want to talk about CoreWeave, because the stock kind of sputtered at first and now it's really going up, and maybe it's because of this small group of investors that's bidding up the stock. Actually, The Information had this headline: the most dangerous game in artificial intelligence investing right now is CoreWeave. Why?
I missed that article, but yeah, I think, I'm not sure. You know, I can't speak for the buyers of the stock and kind of what's in their mind, but certainly there are people that, you know, think it's worth $75 billion, and, you know, if that's the case, you know, markets tend to be efficient. So
how much does it have to do with the skepticism around this AI data center boom? You know, we've seen, for example, you know, Microsoft and Amazon pulling back on some of their commitments. Like, do we really need all these data centers? Or are we going to find a more efficient way to power AI? And I did talk to Sam about this, who said, absolutely, we will, but it's just not happening now.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot has been made of some of these pullbacks, but I would say they're more the exception than the rule. You know, a lot of the conversations I'm involved in, you know, I'm seeing way more demand than we have the capacity to bring online in the near term. So I think, you know, we're going to see a lot of infrastructure built similar to Abilene at probably a bigger scale, and just, you know, the overbuild question. I think, you know, I think in a lot of ways the you know, the overbuild question is like a function of like, oh, what could go wrong with like all these investments being made. I think from my perspective, I think about it like, what could go right? Like, you know, we are completely transforming the ways in which that people work, the way that people live, the way that people operate, and the productivity that, you know, an individual is capable of by adding this superhuman level intelligence. And you know, when you look at the scale and the magnitude of these investments, you know, like what's happening in Abilene, it's like a, you know, it's a cluster, it's a size of a cluster that's never been built. It's a gigawatt scale computer, like single computer essentially. It's all fully interconnected. That's never existed before, and it's going to drive incredible breakthroughs that are going to change people's lives. And, you know, from my perspective, you know, bigger investments than that are going to drive even more breakthroughs and lead to more human prosperity.
How does Stargate compare to xAI's build out in Memphis?
You know, I've only sort of followed loosely the headlines, so I can't comment on a lot of specifics.
Really?
You know, I keep tabs on it, but you know, I think you know, I think the scale of it is, I think what's been announced is about 100,000 H200s. So that's, you know, for the like rough math, like that's like the equivalent of like 50,000 GB200s. Like this, what's being built in Abilene is about 400,000 GB200s. So it's, you know, roughly like 8 times bigger. You know, I think it was certainly impressive what they were able to accomplish. I have tremendous respect for that team, and you know, Crusoe sort of sitting at this foundational layer, we're really just kind of like rooting for the whole space to accelerate, you know, artificial intelligence and the abundance of intelligence and energy that's going to drive prosperity for people.
So OpenAI just announced OpenAI for Countries, and the first one beyond Texas that has been announced is in Abu Dhabi. Apparently Elon wasn't too happy about that. But can you just sort of paint the picture of how you see this AI data center build out unfolding around the world over the next decade? Like, where, I mean, obviously there's different countries that are already becoming hotbeds for popular places for data centers?
Yeah, I think it sort of speaks to, you know, the possibilities that everybody sees in artificial intelligence and the importance it's going to play in everybody's life in the future. But you're seeing massive investments taking place in Europe. You're seeing it in the Middle East with, you know, Stargate UAE. You know, Japan has a lot of incentive programs that they've sort of, you know, put in place to, you know, incentivize a lot of infrastructure to be built in Japan. So it is a global phenomenon, you know, we're excited, you know, just for the space to continue to grow and change people's lives.
So what's next for Crusoe? I mean, where's your next Stargate? I mean, we've been hearing rumors of other locations, other places in Texas, maybe other states. Like, where else are you building?
You know, Crusoe is focused on a lot. You know, I would say the bulk of our investments are being made in the U.S., but we are looking at stuff, you know, across Europe. I can't speak about, you know, specifics, but we are looking at a number of different states, you know, beyond Texas, more expansion in Texas. We love Texas. I think it's a great market with, you know, great resources and, you know, the ability to bring on more abundant energy. You know, one thing that I will say is that, you know, we've taken this very modular approach to how we build the infrastructure. So we've been rapidly scaling up our manufacturing capacity to be able to support a lot of the electrical equipment that makes up one of these big AI data centers. So, you know, we set up a manufacturing facility in Tulsa, Oklahoma, you know, where we have hundreds of people working there today, and that's soon going to be thousands of people that are manufacturing critical electrical components for these big AI data centers. And I think, you know, as people focus often on, you know, wow, AI is going to eliminate all these jobs, I'm sort of sitting at the other end of the spectrum of, like, I can't hire enough people. There, like, simply aren't enough, you know, blue-collar trades, you know, trained workers to basically support the demand we're seeing from the market. So I really believe that this is one of the greatest labor booms that, you know, we've ever seen as a U.S. economy.
Well, maybe all the software engineers who are out of a job can go be data center builders in Abilene.
Well, yeah, train them as electricians.
Last question, because, you know, I know you feel very strongly about the possibilities of AI. You told me that you thought maybe AGI could be born in Abilene, Texas. In talking with Sundar Pichai last night, he was like, yeah, I asked about the limits of AI. Is it possible we don't ever get to AGI? And he was like, yeah, actually, sure, it's possible that we don't get there. Like, are we overestimating what AI can do?
No. I think if anything, we're underestimating it. It's like, you know, I think we're standing at this moment where, you know, you look into the future and it's just a future of infinite possibility of just like what could happen. And I think if you talk to anybody that's working on, you know, the foundational model layer, I think everybody's so impressed with what's happened today. And they're like, just wait to see what's coming. And I think, like, you know, even just looking at the progress over the last 18 months, right? 18 months ago, all anybody could talk about was like, yeah, these things are good, but, like, they hallucinate, and can we really trust them? And, like, hallucinations. Nobody's talking about hallucinations anymore because they've mostly gone away. We've been able to solve it with, you know, more investment in the innovation layer of...
We're still talking about it a little bit. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, just wait.